And I am the executive director of Embark Center for Self-Directed Learning, which is coming to a theater near you in September, September 5th to be exact. So I just want to briefly introduce you to myself and to kind of how we wound up even here in this room together. And then I'm going to turn it over to the real reason that y'all are here. So I have been a teacher for 10 years, a Montessori teacher. I was a social worker before that. And so I've been working with kids for a long time. Throughout the time that I've worked with kids, I've always been sort of mindful of the fact that even though in a Montessori environment, they had a lot more freedom and a lot more flexibility, I still felt like there were so many times where I was really just doing the whole, well, just do this because the state of Virginia says so, or something like that. And I could watch the sort of light in kids' eyes dim just a bit as there was something else that they wanted to be doing. And for some kids, it wasn't quite as nice as that. It got a little ugly for them. It was their experience was painful. So when I realized some of these kids that I'm working with with the best of intentions, I'm actually causing pain, I realized I needed to figure something else out. But I didn't really take it so seriously. I didn't really listen to that message until I went through this with my own daughter. So I have an older son who's 21, and he's going into his last year. I don't know how that happened since I'm only 18. But he is going into his last year at UVA. He was a traditional Loudoun County student, very typical. He jumped through all the hoops. If you put another one in front of him, he'd jump through that one and ask you for three more. And he just did what everyone wanted him to do. And he was successful in that way by the standards that were set for him by the people that that were setting the standards. And so I kind of just, you know, played along. I followed along for the ride. But over time, my middle daughter, who isn't here with us, and I'll tell you a little bit about why later, because that's kind of an interesting thing. She's busy doing something for Embark someplace else. But she actually was a square peg in a round hole from birth. And wasn't going to jump through those traditional hoops. She just wasn't. And when she was going through elementary school, that worked out just fine for her. But as she got older, what wound up happening was she became more aware of the fact that she wasn't the same as the other kids, that she was that square peg in the round hole, that she wasn't jumping through the same hoops. She was probably capable of it, but not really, because she just didn't want to do it. And that created so much pain for her, a lot of anxiety, depression. We struggled on a lot of fronts, and she's been through a lot and has come out on the other side. But through that journey, she assisted me, as you may have seen in the newspaper article, in trying to look for alternatives. What, this can't be it, right? This can't be the only option for teenagers to be able to either to be miserable in school, or to be, you know, I don't know what, you know. So we were looking for alternatives, and it was kind of a rabbit warren of, you know, all kinds of different places that the search led me, and eventually it led me directly to Ken Danford's doorstep, to North Star Self-Directed Learning for Teens, which is in Sutherland, Massachusetts. And North Star has been around for 25 years, and as I read through it, I was like, this sounds a little too good to be true. So I packed up my husband and my youngest daughter and said, because I want teenage eyes on this, I want a real perspective. And we dragged ourselves up to Massachusetts. And all I can say is I walked in the door, spent some time there, visited a few other centers based on the same model, and I drank the Kool-Aid. It was kind of all over from there. So I don't even really need to say a whole lot more about what North Star is about, because these folks are going to do that, and I'll tell you a little bit more about Embark afterwards, but I don't want to take up any time. I'm very grateful. They drove all the way down from Massachusetts, arrived at my house at 4, and here they are. So I would, yes, thank you very much. I will introduce Ken Danford, who is the founder of this model, as well as the director of North Star. And would you like to introduce the panelists, since you know them better? That would be great. So thank you again for coming.
All right. Thank you. This is fantastic. This is one of the favorite activities I get to do, is go around to some of the centers that are starting and do this initial panel presentation and bring along some of the people. This is Laura Ross, Tristan Pitsey, Eva Hardy-Morick, and they'll each have stories to tell you. So what's going to happen is I'm going to talk now for 20 minutes or so about North Star and my story, and then you'll get 5 to 10 minutes apiece of them, and then you can ask questions to any of us, and then we'll stay all as long as you want. You know, but we'll try to make it so that if we want, we can get out of here in an hour or so. You know. Anyway, that's the goal. I'm going to get carried away. But this is fantastic to see all of this energy for Andrea. I mean, everybody here knows her already. Did anybody just wander in off the street and you read about it? You heard those pistachio donuts? How many people are already out of school, homeschooling, unschooling, doing the alternative thing? And how many people are still either parents or kids in school and considering something different for another time? So, I'm going to tell my story. If you look at the North Star website, which is North Star Teens, at the bottom of the homepage, there's a TED Talk, there's a speech I gave in Guernsey, England, and there's an article about alumni all at the bottom of the homepage, and you can get more of me if you want later. But anyway, I grew up in Cleveland, Ohio. Very excited for tomorrow night. One. And I went to public school all the way through. Went to Amherst College. Went to Brown teacher training. Ted Sizer was going to become a principal superintendent, secretary of education, and schools from the inside. And got disillusioned about 6 years into public school teaching. And briefly, that looked like, at first, I thought it was about what we needed was more money and teachers better and more curriculum reform and more space for creativity and trust the teachers and all that kind of thing. And then I decided that wasn't really all of it, and it really was about giving choice to kids, and asking kids, you know, well, the biggest problem is the kids don't want to do that. We're trying to make kids do things, and that when kids don't work, it's somehow my failure to inspire them. It's all my fault that they don't want to learn about whatever the topic of the week was. And I finally decided to reject that, you know, 6 years before I fully decided it wasn't really my fault. Or that I didn't want to own that problem. That was not the problem I wanted to work with for the rest of my life. And I thought of it in a sense of a lot of kids here are experiencing school with some stress. Only about a quarter of them or so are on a roll being told they're good at this game. Even the ones who are doing that, many of them are doing that with a certain amount of anxiety and energy and overwork and unhappiness. If you look at them, how many of the people on honor roll are doing well without too much stress and just doing school are actually mostly amused and interested and thankful for what they have the opportunity to learn in school? And it's like, are you down to like, what, 4 kids? 2 kids? 1? You know, like, oh good, I get to go to school and learn all these cool things from these cool teachers and they even give me grades. Isn't that fun? No one does that. But even if they are, if you find any kids like that, even they prefer summer. Even they want snow days. Even they can't wait for school to be over so they can finally do the thing they love. I want to be there with the thing they love. I want to be the guy they go to when it's time for fun. I don't want to be the guy they get away from like they did him, so now they can do the thing. I want to be that one. I don't want to spend my life being the goof that they're just like putting up with. Too young. I was 30 at the time. That? How do you get to be that? Well, you either work an after school thing, or you do the weekends, you do the summer camps, you do some magical thing. And you know, I know there's teachers at school who do magic. You know, there's a theater teacher, there's a niche, there's a science. You know, everybody encounters one great teacher sometime who changes their lives. That's true. But that's so much luck, and it's not frequent enough for me to have my career on. Not good enough, right? When most kids, it doesn't happen with most kids most days, most of the time. Forget it. There's got to be a better way to work with kids than this. And I really felt I was harming children, as Andrea just said, you know, that I was making kids' lives worse. They were coming out of this project of schooling feeling bad about themselves, or worried, or negative, or they hate history or science, whatever they didn't. This is not working out the way it's supposed to. We're not creating engaged, lively, vibrant citizens who are going to go out there and change the world. They just can't wait to get done with us. So they can finally do what they want. That's really discouraging. And my friend Joshua Hornick was a science teacher. Had a slightly different take. I was worried about the individual stressors and the kids who were suffering. And he more globally decided these kids are just settling for mediocrity. What should be the most vibrant and exciting time in the kid's life, you know, 14, 15, 16, where they're living at home, they don't have that much responsibility, they really want. They're just doing nothing. They're just being wasted. And they're just waiting to be 18. This is terrible. So that was discouraging. And if you are hearing the thread, you can see that I wasn't going to move to a private school. I wasn't going to go to a charter school. I wasn't going to create a charter school. The problem was schooling. That's kind of a dead end. What do? You know, you either become a niche, a teacher with a niche in the school, and you do the best you can with the kids you find, and you work with it, and a lot of that's what most teachers who settle for that do. It works. I mean, it's a thing you can do. Or you leave the profession. Hopefully either one of the two, and not swallowing the other. I wasn't really ready to do either of those two things. And so Joshua, my colleague with a science degree, he wanted to tell me about homeschooling, and I was like, shut up with homeschooling. That was like, what's that? Right? And this is 1995 or 4. Finally, I took the Teenage Liberation Handbook after one ridiculous episode with the principal. I read the book and I was like, oh my God. You all know the Teenage Liberation Handbook by Grace Llewellyn? My first introduction was written in the early 90s. And it's about kids who not only are homeschooling, but they're unschooling. They're not trying to do a little of everything and trying to do school at home. They're just, you know, do your horses, do your cooking, learn your Spanish, be a mathematician. Just do what you love and see what happens, would you? It's like adults. It's like growing up with for children. In a positive way. I didn't know you could do that. I never heard of that. That's ridiculous. And according to this book, the people who did it get away with it. They're cheating. No wonder they win the science contests and the spelling bee. Stupid homeschoolers. No one has anything else to do. And they get into college and they start businesses and they're entrepreneurial and they're 16 and they're all mature and they talk about 21. You're like, what? Who are these people? This is what? So I was in a doctorate program at the time at UMass to become a principal superintendent, and I started, you know, using every excuse to read all the books and interview all the local homeschoolers, like 7 unschoolers I could find at the time. It was true, I mean they were a little quirky, but no quirkier than, you know, the random set of people anyway. And I was doing the college admissions letters, and I was calling up all these, you know, 100 universities throughout the year. It was all true, right? I mean, I convinced myself that this weird subculture I never heard of, homeschooling in general, unschooling in particular, was a valid thing. It's like discovering veganism or home birthing or some weirdo thing that those hippies do. I don't know, right? Like, all right. But if that's true, why isn't everybody doing it? Right? I mean, if it's so much better and so healthier, like, what are we all doing here? What am I doing here, right? And, you know, the answer is instantaneously obvious. This is not, we didn't really have a conversation. This is a thought process. Because it's ridiculous, it's a dumb word, it's a bad idea, it's a turn off. No one wants to do this. Kids don't want to do it. Parents don't want to do it. Nobody even say the word in our family conversation. And even when you do it, you gotta be really confident and competent and multi-talented, you know, skilled to do all the things to make homeschooling and unschooling successful for the long-term, sustainable. You know, you gotta manage a lot of stuff, find a lot of people, be resourceful. You don't have to teach them. You know, the whole thing. It's beyond. You know, people are already struggling with work and their own family and their own lives and their own hobbies. And it's not what kids and parents mostly in America want to do. There's a few of you who do, but that's beside the point, really, for the situation I was in, teaching a bunch of eighth graders in public school who mostly didn't want to be there and trudging through the motions and somewhat being harmed by the process. So Joshua and I decided that the only logical, the obviously logical thing to do would be to quit our jobs and help all the school kids quit school. It wasn't really funny. It was the obvious thing to do. It's not a joke.
What would it take to help all these nitwits in our classes who were never going to read Grace's book, never going to discuss this with their parents, whose parents would be shut up, get out of here, you know, and run for the hills? I mean, this is like ludicrous, right? Mom, Mr. Anderson said we could homeschool. Ridiculous, right? I mean, if I gave Grace, if I told everybody about her in school, you know, like, who would read the book and then who would do it? Nobody. One. It's irrelevant, right? For our public policy, for a thing. So what would it take to change that? What would we have to do to help all these school kids be like these healthy, happy, homeschooling, unschooling people, right? Because we could have barged in on them and get them to pay us. There's no business there. Like, oh, we're here to teach you history and science because you must not be getting it without us. You know, that's preposterous and idiotic, and it wouldn't really be a major project in life or morally redeeming or that useful to anybody other than perhaps ourselves to try to make money in that way. But that was never an idea for us to barge in on the unschooling and homeschooling community and get them all to pay us to teach their kids. That was never a part of North Star. It's not part of Liberty Learns. It's not part of what Andrea's model or vision is, right? The vision was always to say, you know, these kids that you don't really understand, they're doing quite well. There's a real valid lifestyle out here that people don't understand. And we're going to help all you mainstream people who don't get it, get it. Jailbreak. We're going to get everybody out of here. Who wants to go? We're going to quit our jobs, open up on the corner. Who wants to meet us there instead of go to school next year, right? So what do you have to offer? In fact, this is a good one to say in public to you guys. What's the least you have to offer to make that appealing, vibrant, successful, sustainable for people to actually make that leap, right? I don't need to overdo it. I just want to be enough so that any kid isn't trapped in school tomorrow, right? That they come and meet with me and I say, well, you don't have to go to school. There's a way to find you. Don't go tomorrow. What do I have to do? Well, it turns out this is not rocket science. This is not genius. It's just bothering to do it. And most of you can think this through in your own heads without me telling you this. This is not some secret formula, right? But if you're going to talk to a bunch of 8th grade school kids and their parents or 12th and 10th grade, people hit the wall in school. And it can be for younger kids, just that Josh and I chose to start with the teenagers. But you could do this for younger kids if that was your heartfelt thing to do. Well, we're not doing this out of a garage or out of our houses or out of the library. We're going to get a rented space. We're going to have a building, an office. And we're going to do our little classes, little tutoring. Before that, we're going to call these people in one at a time and explain to them how to become a homeschooler. This is what you got to write the school plan. No one really reads it. No one really cares about the thing at the end of the year. But there's a process to it. You be cordial and polite about it. And in 21 years, we've had zero problems with superintendents from all over anywhere, right? This is not an adversarial process. It's very simple. People don't know that. People are terrified of it. But filing a homeschooling notification, or in our case, a curriculum plan, is very simple. You know, it's probably harder to get your driver's permit, guys. Really, it's just nothing. And you know, at the end of the year, you gotta send them a letter that says, yeah, they read some books and went and played, and it was fun, and they're happy, and we'll tell you more next year, and it's fine. And they're like, whatever, check. You know, they don't want to argue with you. Just be reasonable and be. There's a little bit of coaching, right? But the real coaching is, it's not about being legal. It's about making a lifestyle and a plan that feels good to everybody in the family. We're not asking you to surrender your parenting. You don't automatically have to unschool and let the kid be the boss of everything and just give up. You could. I mean that respectfully. Like, that's a family choice for some kids, for some parents, who are just like, you know, summers are great. Kids, you know, it's all, we're always amazed. It's fine. But the, you know, different families have different rules or needs or expectations for different kids, different years, different moments. So that's fine. You know, some read a book. Some say, stop reading so much. What's that, right? Helping people negotiate the whole concept that if you don't have school bossing you around, telling you what to do and when enough is enough, and oh, stop, don't read any more about that topic, go on to the next. You know, what is enough and how to think about it is really helpful to have an advisor, a non-parental adult, a coach, you know, from the North Star type place, in there having this conversation with you and your kids, adults and kids. We're not bossing them. We're just coaching, listening, helping, trying to resolve conflict, and listening. Anyway, helping to become a legal homeschooler, trying to address everybody's concerns and come up with, like, what would the routine look like? Would you ever go out of the house? Would you never go out of the house? Would you ever read a book? Would you ever pick up a pencil? Would you ever count again? What would you do if you don't have to go to school? Like, that's a really fascinating conversation with a 13-year-old. No one has that conversation. Some of you have that about summer in a very limited way, or what do you want to do with the after school or the weekend? But you know how marginal that is when the real thing is school and you only get to do the extra stuff if you're good at school in the first place or whatever, right? Throw out the whole school thing, empty the plate, and they're like, well, what do you want? What are the priorities? So you want drawing to be first. So you want gardening to be first, or singing. You can do that. Maybe, you know? So coaching that conversation. And helping the family stay together in the process. So that parents and kids see themselves on the same team rather than as adversaries is crucial. That's what we do. That's really actually most of what we do. Except that isn't enough, because you just coach people and say, now go do it. That's not good. That's not enough. So we host a center, a gathering spot, and then, you know, this is, again, not genius. It's like a YMCA. It's a club. It's like a senior center. So what do you have at the center? You got a bunch of adults. You got some classes. You got a book group. You got a writing group. You got a theater. You got a rock band. You got yoga. You'll hear about it all, right? There's a bunch of things that happen. They're all voluntary. Don't do any of them. Come and don't do any of them. You have a lot of people offering tutorials. They could be, you know, math and calculus. They could be Spanish. They could be dog training. I don't know. Do anything you want. We try to find kids internships and support them with the jobs and the volunteer work and think about college and part-time college and you know, community college when they're 15 or 16 and how to apply to four-year schools, and 80% of the kids go to college from North Star. It's not a thing. And we host a social center where they can just be. So if you're not interested in the groups that are happening, or you're not interested in a tutorial, you just want to come and play or talk or read your book, but there, you're welcome to come and fall asleep at North Star. You come and go as you please. It's like a library or a senior center. We're not in charge of them. I'm not trying to get kids to do things. I don't see myself as someone who motivates children. Or I somehow, you know, self-directed learning is not a trick to get kids to do school of their own free will. Just stop it. Just grow up. Just do each thing. Right? Tell us what it is that you would like to do. Try to make a commitment. Try to declare. For some of the kids, that's the hardest thing to do, is simply declare an interest. Because they've never done it before. They know the parents are going to mock them out and make fun of them. Or, even worse, the parents are going to be like, oh, you're interested in fish. And they come back from the library with 72 books and 4 videos and 6 phone numbers for the kids, right? Oh my God, I'm never going to think again, right? So it's really hard, right? I mean, it's not that easy. Life's harder than it is funny, but we're trying. So North Shore is a place where you can come and just be, and the staff is going to, you're going to have advice, you're going to have conversations, you're going to have these invitations, you're going to have these opportunities, but you can say no thank you to anything you don't want to do. You can come in 1, 2, 3, 4 days a week, right? And for me and for Joshua, the central part of it is we're not going to be at school. We're not going to try to get kids to do things. We're not going to give them grades. We're not going to give them credits. We're not going to give them diplomas. We're not going to take attendance. They can come or go as they please, like normal people, like us at the gym. Like, hopefully you don't get badgered unless you have a personal trainer, but you know. And maybe you know that that is okay to not get credits and grades and transcripts from a school. And maybe you know, this is a punchline, maybe you know that there's not a single thing you can do with a high school diploma that you can't do without one. Zero things are opened by high school diplomas. There's not a single thing. Oh, what's it called? Loudoun, what's the school that?
Loudoun County.
Okay, no, Kaya, where are you, Kaya?
Loudoun Valley High School,
whatever it's called here that she goes to. Loudoun Valley High School graduates can do that homeschoolers can't do sooner, better, differently, fine, and younger. You know that? That's a fact. You might need a GED if you were the military or AmeriCorps or Peace Corps. Okay? But you can go to Harvard and you can have any job, you can start a business. So there's not a single thing that people who choose to skip high school are excluded from for that choice. Unless you really want to get technical with me and start talking about high school class reunions and proms. There is nothing in this culture in this country, this is enough for me to be patriotic, that you can't do in the United States. It's not true in every country in the world. But in the United States, you can go to community college, you can get an associate's degree by the time you're 17 or 18, and go on to a four-year school, with or without your GED, you'll hear about this in a minute, right? We've had kids go to all five of our colleges, like the Amherst, UMass, Hampshire, Mount Holyoke, Smith, and all over the country. I didn't bring the poster, I'm sorry I didn't bring the poster, but just, it's done, right? The homeschoolers the last 30, 40 years are everywhere, and successfully. The kids started businesses. One is actually called public school superintendent. One did, in fact, run away and join circus, you know, the arms of the play circus kind of thing. This is not news, this is not North Star only, but North Star is supporting kids who wouldn't do it otherwise. We're trying to take a lifestyle that in 1995 was not supported by any outside organization, only people who had ridiculous parents and some kind of wherewithal to do it were able to utilize this lifestyle. And today, you know, homeschooling is still largely a K through 8 kind of activity. A lot of people who homeschool, the vast majority choose to go to high school because of lots of reasons that happen socially and educationally at that age. And we're saying that's just the time to get out. So you made it through elementary school, it work. Skip middle school, and if you're on a year like that, you consider high school, right? So far so good?
You're not allowed to pick enough yet.
This is crazy talk. This is crazy talk to conventional homeschoolers as much as it's crazy talk to school people. Right? They can just not go to school, and the adults aren't going to make you write essays, and you can just go sign up for psychology, community college, and somehow you'll know how to muddle through and write a paper and get the credit, and then you like it and you sign up for more. It happens every day. I see kids are getting expelled from the local high school, walk across the street to the community college, and get A's in economics at 15 years old. You're angry, pissed off kids in school that go sign up for economics. And I don't care if they go to college or not, because we have kids who are starting businesses and they don't want to be in school, and they don't want to, for some kids, community college can just feel like glorified high school in certain moments. That's okay too. Though, I'd like to tell you that you can go to college. I don't say you have to, and I'm not saying that all North Star kids need to or ought to go to college. They can go to work, and they can just be as industrious and musical and artistic. We have world-class jazz musicians and blues musicians. We have a young women's rock band that's spreading across the country. You know, the artists and musicians are thriving as well. So it's not, I don't mean to say it's all about it. I carried away from trying to prove you it's all about it. So, the thing for me at North Star also has been to make it accessible and inclusive to every single child. We turn nobody away for money. We turn nobody away for being a hard case. We work with every single person who comes in the door. So, the first meeting with me ends with, well, if you'd like to visit, you can. And seriously, yesterday could be your last day of school. So don't go around. Right? No one has ever said that to these children before, at least nobody respectable. Right? You can see the body language changing. I see the body language changing in front of me. In the middle of the meeting, kids pissed off having come to some other idiotic meeting with their parents. And it's amazing. So, about, in the article I wrote about the alumni, how am I doing on time? I'm getting carried away. Alright, I'll be wrapped up in a minute, but yeah, I leave it out of that. So I think more than half of the kids come into the North Star thriving, or at least managing school. They go every day, they pass, they get into grades. And without North Star, they would just be your normal kids who just graduate on time. But, you know, a little sad, or a little bored. A little like, couldn't I have done more, right? That's more than half of the kids. Everybody isn't coming into trouble, or, you know, a mess. But less than half, about 40%, are coming in with a mixture of problems. You know, they're not going to school every day. Some of them have anxiety and depression, or other kinds of health woes, or self-harming, or suicidal issues. And some of them don't have any of those issues, but they're just mad. They've just quit. Give me an F. I really don't care. I'm not doing another worksheet. Here's my pencil. Snap. I'm not doing your test. You know, fill in whatever colored boxes you want me to answer. state test, but I'm not really trying hard. And if I were bigger than my mother, I would not go to school. Yeah, you know. If they can't force me, I'm not getting out of the room, right? Give kids locking the door, right? But they're not. Take a breath and hear the concept and just say, okay, I'm in, right? And parents have to be in there too. It involves some letting go, some trust, some faith that somehow 2 or 3 years or 4 years of life without school will get us at least to the same place, if not a better one, probably a better one, than 2 or 3 more years of shoving this kid through the system. Where, what are we going to get? We're going to get a C- of that GPA and a why? Right? Just, you know, more. For, kids are going to be 17, 18 years old for 3 or 4 years ahead of where they are today by getting out of school at 13 or 14. So I'm going to have to think about that while these guys talk. And the thing is, like, well, I mean, a lot of us put up with school. I liked school. That's when I became a teacher. I was really good at school. And, you know, I was pretty good at it. And I, you know, I became a teacher pretty enthusiastically back in the day. And this isn't my experience. I didn't yearn to be out of school when I was 15 or 16 or 17. And, you know, I went straight through to college in 4 years and pretty nerdy about it, to be honest with you. This is coming from teaching kids and trying to figure out how do I relate to these kids in a different way. And just to give a little context to here, in the past, you know, 6 or 7 years, North Star has become stable enough to discuss as a model. Joel Hammond in Princeton was the first person to start a second center. In Ottawa, in New Haven, in Grand Rapids, in Boston, Massachusetts, in Dedham, and another one in Leominster, and one in West Hartford. And there's people starting centers in Canton, New York, of course. And we have people here, we have people in Vermont, Burlington, people in Texas. It's just random. People who happen to call, see North Star and say, I think I want to start this. You know, they call, we have this conversation, I try to scare them off, because it's hard, and you don't make money. Do you really want to do this? You're going to come to school people? Sure. And then they do a video thing and they do the planning stages and then they get to this stage. So, you know, we're trying to actually weed them out because we don't need everybody but everybody mess. And, you know, putting their jobs in there. Right? It's just too hard. But anyway, so this is how far Andrea's gotten. And it's awesome. It's totally amazing. Right? And you're all here. And so this seems really, really encouraging. It's happening really easily. Okay. We'll take questions and I'll talk more. And I'll stay as long as you want because you're here. Okay, so far so good?